Today, we are very happy to welcome Ian Chaubet, who is going to tell us about closed geodesics with prescribed intersection numbers. As usual, don't hesitate to ask questions during the talk, either by unmuting yourself or writing them in the chat. We will let Ian know if you have a question in the chat.
Okay, so thank you very much, Laura, for the introduction, and thank you very much to the organizers, Alexandre, Jean, and Laura, for the invitations. I'm very glad to talk today. Okay, so as Laura said, don't hesitate to interrupt me if you have any questions, so I will be happy to answer. So the subject of my talk today will be closed geodesics with prescribed intersection numbers. So I will be interested in counting closed geodesics on negatively curved surfaces. And I will be interested to impose some constraints on those geodesics and to see if we are able to count them. Okay, so first I will introduce the setting and give some examples of results that already exist in the literature about some constraints that you can impose, and then I will talk about which constraint I was interested in. Okay, so the context is the following. So you take a negatively curved surface. So you assume it to be closed, connected, oriented, and negatively curved. And you denote by P the set of primitive closed geodesics of the surface. So by primitive, I just mean that I take only the first iterate of closed geodesic. So for example, if I have one closed geodesic, I can do twice the turn, and this one is not primitive, and I am interested in only primitive geodesics. And so there is a result, a famous result of Margolis, which is the following. You denote by H the topological entropy of the geodesic flow. If you don't know what is topological entropy, you can just take the following result as a definition for the topological entropy. And the result of Margolis says that if you look at the number of primitive closed geodesics of lengths that is not greater than L, where L is a number positive, then this number is asymptotic to exponential of HL over HL when L goes to infinity. So what I mean by this sign here is just that the ratio of the left-hand side and the right-hand side converges to one as L goes to infinity. Okay. So this result was actually already known for hyperbolic surfaces. So hyperbolic surfaces are negatively curved surfaces for which the curvature is constant and equal to minus one. So in this case, this result follows from the works of Delsarte, Huber, and Selberg. And in this case, the entropy is equal to one. Okay. And so our goal today will be to study such asymptotic results for the growth of closed geodesics, for which we will want to impose a constraint, a geometrical constraint or topological constraint. So what I want to say is that we will consider a subset C of the closed geodesics, and we will want to understand the asymptotic behavior of the number of closed geodesics in the subset C, such that the length is not greater than L. All right. So before starting to talk about which constraint we can impose, I just want to talk about how can we prove such an asymptotic result. So first of all, we can note the analogy of the Margolis result. We can note that there is an analogy with the prime number theorem. So if you take the Margolis result and you replace exponential of HL by X, you obtain that you obtain x over log x, which is the asymptotic bound for the prime number theorem. So the modern proof to prove the prime number theorem is to apply a Tauberian theorem to the logarithmic derivative of the Riemann zeta function. Okay, so this is very this is a modern proof to prove this result. So the analytical properties of the Riemann zeta function allow you to recover the asymptotic distribution of prime numbers. And in fact, it follows from a result of Parry and Polycott that we can do the same for primitive closed geodesics of negatively curved surface by replacing the Riemann zeta function with the Ruhl zeta function, which consists in replacing the prime numbers by the exponential of minus the length of the geodesics. So it's really this function is the equivalent of the Riemann zeta function, but it's a kind of a geometric equivalent. And using like Markov partition techniques and Ruhl transfer operators, Parry and Polycott show that you can recover Margulis results by using this zeta function and by using the fact that this zeta function has a pole at the entropy. Okay. So now I will impose the first constraint on the geodesics. So a natural question you may ask is the following: is okay, I have when I have a closed geodesic, it defines a homology class in the first homology group. So I may ask, okay, given any homology class, how many closed geodesics are there in this homology class? So this is what studied Lalay and Polycott, who proved the following result like independently. So you take any homology class Xi, and you want to understand the number of closed geodesics primitive of lengths not greater than L and which lie in the homology class Xi. Okay, and the result says that this number is asymptotic to C, a constant C times exponential of HL, so which was present in Margulis results, and you divide it by L to the power G plus one. And here, what I did not say is that G is the genus of the surface. So what is kind of striking in this result is that the constant C here does not depend on the homology class. Okay, so there are also some results. So in this generality, this result was proved by Lalay and Polycott. But for hyperbolic surfaces, it was proved by Philippe Sarnac, who actually obtained a more precise result. They had other terms in the asymptotic development. Also, Katsuda and Tsunada proved it for hyperbolic surfaces. And then there are more precise results for more general flows than geodesic flows. So it was proven by Sharp, and then more complicated result by Babillot, Laudrapier, Polycott, Sharp, and Ananta Raman. And we can even make the homology class depend on the length L here. Okay, so I don't want to go too much details here, but what can I say about the proof of this result? Is that we can use, as I said before, we can use a zeta function, which is kind of a twisted Ruhl zeta function. So if you remember my last slide, I introduced the Ruhl zeta function, which was exactly this zeta function, but without this term here. So here I just take my Ruhl zeta function and I introduce a term which is gonna twist this zeta function by some character here, chi, which is a character on the first homology group. And what you can show is that you can understand the poles of this zeta function. And by integrating over the space of characters, you can actually recover this result. And so for people who are familiar to Dirichlet L series, this twisted zeta function is kind of the equivalent of Dirichlet L series, the geometric equivalent of Dirichlet L series, and the Dirichlet L series are used to prove some arithmetic progression theorems. So this is kind of a geometrical arithmetic progression theorem. Okay, so that was a first constraint you may want to impose. A second constraint you may want to impose on closed geodesics is the self-intersection number. Okay, so what is the self-intersection number? Okay, it's just the following. So you take a closed geodesic on your surface, and you just count how many times it intersects itself. So for example, on my picture here, this closed geodesic intersects itself one time, and this one does not intersect itself. So we will say that it is simple. And so there is a very famous result of Mirzakhani who proved the following. So in the case where the surface is hyperbolic, so meaning that it has a constant curvature equal to one, minus one, then you can show the following. You take any number k, any natural number k, and what you can prove is that there is a constant ck such that the number of closed geodesics with lengths not greater than l and with a self-intersection number which is equal to k, this number is asymptotic to the constant ck times l to the power 6g minus 6. So here again, g is the genus of the surface. And so what you can see is that here, this result is completely different from the previous one, because the growth that you obtain on the number of geodesic when you impose the self-intersection number is only polynomial, whereas before we had an exponential growth. And in fact, this fact follows because imposing the self-intersection number is a very, very hard constraint. Why do I say this? Because there is a result of Lallet which says that a typical closed geodesics intersects itself a number of times which is proportional to the square of its length. So meaning that if I call I of gamma gamma the self-intersection number of the geodesic gamma, typically what you will have is that I of gamma gamma is equal to a constant times the length of gamma to the squared. So if you impose I of gamma gamma to be constant, it is a very strong constraint since geodesic typically want to intersect a lot itself. Okay, so I can mention a lot also other results from Sapir, Souto, and Erlandson Souto, who also counted like closed geodesics in type of curves. But those results are kind of different. Okay. So now I come to a third constraint you may want to impose on closed geodesics. So we will start by a simple case. So we will fix a simple closed geodesic, on our surface, and we will assume it for now to be not separating. So not separating, it means that if I cut my surface along this geodesic, I obtain only one piece. All right. Sorry, there is somebody lifting his hand.
Hi, just to go back a slide. These results of Mirzakhani are for hyperbolic surfaces. Mm-hmm. Is there anything like this for variable negative curvature?
I don't think so. I think that there is a result of Erlandson and Souto, which say that if you consider a hyperbolic metric on your surface, and you consider the simple geodesics, and now if you measure the lengths of those simple geodesics, but which are geodesics for the hyperbolic structure, if you measure this length with respect to another metric, which has variable negative curvature, then you will have this result as well. But I don't know if this result will hold if you ask that the geodesics are geodesics for the negative curvature metric. I would say it's not known, but
okay, thank you.
All right. So thank you for your question. Okay, so now I take a simple closed geodesic on my surface and I assume it to be not separating. And so a natural question you may ask is, okay, given this geodesic, which I call the gamma star, how many closed geodesics are there on my surface which intersect a fixed number of times this geodesic gamma star? So for example, I want to consider only closed geodesics that intersect this geodesic gamma star like 3 times. Okay, and how many are they? Can I say something? Can I have an asymptotic expansion? And so the answer is yes, and it goes as follows. So what you can show is the following. You can show that there is a constant C star another constant H star, which is between 0 and H, such that if you take an integral number n, the number of closed geodesics that are of lengths not greater than L and which intersect exactly n times the geodesic gamma star, this number is asymptotic to C star times L to the power n over factorial n times exponential of H star L over H star L. So this this term here, it's really similar to the Margulis asymptotic term, but with a different entropy. So here, so this result is kind of in between the result of Lalay and Polycott and the result of Mirzakhani, in the sense that we still have an exponential growth of the number of closed geodesics satisfying this constraint, but the exponential growth is smaller than Margulis exponential growth. Okay, and it can be explained by the fact that typically a closed geodesic gamma intersect a number of times intersect gamma star a number of times which is proportional to its length. So it means that when you want to impose an intersection number with gamma star, it is not. Sorry?
So Yann, there's a question in the chat asking if it's for constant curvature.
No, it's a variable curvature. It's a variable curvature. So it works in a general setting of variable curvature, yeah. Sorry, I did not mention that. And so what I was saying is that imposing this intersection number is not as strong as imposing a self-intersection number. Okay,
and there's another question which is asking if C star is, for instance, H minus H star.
Okay, that's a very good question, because in fact, if you sum over n, the right hand side, then you recognize the exponential series, right? And so you want to say that H star plus C star is equal to H. And the answer is, I don't know if it's true. And I don't think it's true, because if I fix L and I sum the left hand side here, then this sum is finite, because if L is fixed, and if you want to intersect, I don't know, a billion times gamma star, then you have to have some lengths. So if L is equal to 100, you cannot intersect a billion times gamma star. So, but on the other hand, if you sum the right terms, you will have every term is positive, so you sum way more things. And another reason for which I think it's not true is that if you take a graph, like a discrete graph, and you want to count closed orbits, closed path in your graph, when you remove an edge, like you want to say you want to count closed paths passing a fixed number of time in some edge, and you also have this kind of result. But when you and I did the computation by hand and with computer, and I don't find that C star plus H star is equal to H. So I don't see any reasons that would make this work. Okay. Okay. So let me describe. I don't know if there are some. Okay. Okay. So let me describe a little bit what is H star and C star. So first, the number H star, in fact, is the entropy of the geodesic flow of the surface you obtain by cutting your surface along gamma star. So I take my surface and I cut it along gamma star, which I fixed, and I obtain a surface with boundary, like this one. And now I have a geodesic flow, which is not complete, because I can go out, but still there are some people here which will spend all their lives in the surface, and so you can still define an entropy for the geodesic flow, so which is the entropy of the geodesic flow, the topological entropy of the geodesic flow, which is which you restrict to the trapped set, so the set of vector v in the cosphere bundle. So remember that the geodesic flow acts on the set of tangent vectors on the surface, and so you look at all the vectors which stays an infinite time in your surface, and so you have a flow on a compact subset, and you can define the topological entropy, and H star is precisely this topological entropy. Another remark is that if you take n equal to zero, so let me go back to this result. If I take n equal to zero, I just obtain the Margulis term. Okay, and this result was already known, and it follows from the works of Paris-Polycot, who showed some asymptotic growth of closed orbits for axiom A flows, and the work of Dalbo, who showed that if you have a negatively curved surface with a totally geodesic boundary, then you are in the position to apply the Paris and Polycot result. Okay, and what I was saying earlier is the following large deviation result that you can show by using intersection currents and the result by Kiefer, which says the following. It says that there is some constant I star, such that for any epsilon positive and epsilon positive, there is a delta, such that the number of closed geodesics which are of length not greater than L, and for which the ratio of the intersection number between gamma and gamma star divided by the length minus, I mean, is far from the constant I star. This is, there are exponentially less geodesics like that if you compare to the total number of closed geodesics. So this is just the ratio of the number of geodesics, such that this intersection number is far from a constant times the length, and you divide it by the number of the total number of closed geodesics, and you obtain that there are exponentially less geodesics like that. So just to say that typically a geodesic intersect a number of times gamma star, which is proportional to its length. Okay. Okay, and before before coming to the ideas of the proof of this result, I just say briefly that this result also works if you fix a family of simple closed geodesics. So what I do is now I take my surface and I fix a family of pairwise disjoint simple closed geodesics, which I call gamma star one, gamma star r. And now I want to do the same thing. I want to, for each simple closed geodesics I fixed, I want to impose an intersection number. So for example, in my drawing, I want to count the closed geodesics gamma such that it intersects one time gamma star one, two time gamma star two, one time gamma star three, etc. Okay, and so so that's what I was saying. So you want to count the number of closed geodesics which are of lengths not greater than L, and such that it intersects n1 times gamma star 1, n2 times gamma star 2, etc. And the result says that you can find a constant Cn, an integer Dn, and a constant Hn, such that the number of closed geodesics satisfying your constraints that you imposed is asymptotic to the constant times L to the power dn times Margulis type term. So you have a similar result. Of course, you cannot impose any constraints. I mean, you cannot ask your geodesics to intersect gamma star one one time, gamma star three one time, but not gamma star two. It's not possible by the intermediate value theorem. So there are some obvious topological constraints that that you want to satisfy. Okay, and what I want to say is that the number Hn is equal to one of the entropies of the surfaces you obtain by cutting your surface along the simple closed geodesics. So in my picture here, when I cut my surface along gamma star one or along gamma star two, gamma star three, etc., I obtain three surfaces. I obtain sigma one, I obtain also sigma two, and I obtain also sigma three. And each of those surfaces with boundary have a topological entropy, as I said before. And so this number Hn is related to the entropy of one of those surfaces. Okay, so if there are not any questions, maybe I will go further. And
yeah, you said it's one of the surfaces, but which one and why only?
Okay,
one?
So it is the entropy. It's the maximal entropy. I mean, it depends if your geodesic will travel through all the surfaces. For example, okay, if I just want my geodesics to travel between sigma one and sigma two, the entropy will be the maximum of the entropies of the two. Yeah. And in my example, it travels around everyone, so it will be the maximum. And actually, dn here, the number dn is the number of times you will travel through this surface of maximal entropy.
Thank you. Clear.
Right, thank you. Okay, so now I will start to give some ideas of the proof. So the main object I use, which is very important, is the dynamical scattering operator. So I come back to the case where I have only one geodesic and I cut my surface along this geodesic. All right, and then I have two boundaries, okay, and I consider the space of vectors which are based on the boundary, okay, and I call the exit time of a vector which is at the boundary, I call it T star of XV. So it is just the first time for which I will exit my surface. So for example, I take this vector XV, I follow the geodesic flow, okay, I travel, etc. And at some time, eventually, I will come out. And T star is this number, is the time for which I will come out. Okay, so some vectors are trapped inside, but most of them will go out. Okay, and what I call the scattering map is the following. I take some vector, and I just take, and the scattering map of this vector, applied to this vector, is simply the exit vector. Okay, so I take XV, I follow the geodesic flow, and then I go out. And this is what I call S of XV. And of course, this map is not defined on the set of vectors which we spend an infinite time in the surface, because I won't go out, so I don't have an exit vector simply. Okay. So this is what I call S. And gamma here is a set of vectors for which I don't have an exit vector. Okay. And what I call the scattering operator, S of S, is simply the transfer operator associated to the scattering map. Okay, so what do I mean by that? It means that the scattering operator S applied to F, when I compute it on a vector XV, it is the value of F at the exit vector. Okay, so if I have a function f which takes its value on I don't know how outward going vectors, so for example I just for each outgoing vector I give a value and it gives me a function, and then my scattering operator takes this function which is on outgoing vectors and it gives me a function which is a function on incoming vectors. Okay, and I add a weight here, an exponential weight, which will help me to keep track of the time I spent inside the surface. Okay, and S here is a complex number, and it will be in fact my spectral parameter. Okay, and the main thing you want to note is that a closed geodesic which intersects, for example, one time gamma star is simply a fixed point of the scattering map. Okay, and if I want to understand the fixed point of a scattering map, it's often useful to study the associated transfer operator. Okay. Okay, so before coming to computing a trace of this scattering operator, I have to introduce the resolvent of the geodesic flow in my surface. Okay. So when you have a totally geodesic boundary, it is kind of difficult to do some analysis because the trapped set, so the is really it arrives very near the totally geodesic boundary. For example, you will have closed geodesics that will approximate this part here, and this it's very complicated to do analysis. So the first thing that you do is that you add some some part in your surface. You extend a bit your surface to obtain a convex boundary. So what does it mean? It means that if here is gamma star. And if I go a bit further gamma star, then I will go out and I cannot come back. And this is very convenient to do some analysis. Okay, so I call just this new surface, I call it sigma delta. So delta is just the length of the piece I added. And I call M delta the unit tangent bundle. Okay, so just a set of vectors based at a point in M delta. And I have a new exit time, which is a T delta, which is the first, I take a vector here, for example, and then I travel and I have a time for which I will go out. So of course, some vectors won't go out, but most of them will. And so there is a very strong result of Dyatlov and Guillermo, which is the following. So you consider the operator R of S. So in fact, R of S is you need to think of R of S as a resolvent for the geodesic flow. So what is the operator R of S is when you apply it to a function F, which is supported in the M delta, the unit tangent bundle of your extended surface, and you integrate the value of F along the lines of the flow until you go out, and you add also an exponential weight here. All right? So this is an operator. And thanks to the exponential weight, it defines a nice operator if the real part of S is big. Okay, and the theorem of Dyatlov and Guillermo says that R of S, which is well defined if the real part of S is big, will extend to a meromorphic family of operators. Okay, so it's really like the resonance is for the Laplacian in Rn. You have a well-defined resolvent for the imaginary part, which is big, and then you can extend this resolvent meromorphically, and you obtain poles. And so this is really the same thing, and the what you obtain, the poles of this resolvent, are the polycotruel resonances. So those are resonances that will be important to study the long-time behavior of the geodesic flow, for example, if you want to obtain the mixing properties of the geodesic flow, etc. Okay, so what do I call it? The resolvent is just because it satisfies, it is the inverse of X minus S, where X is the geodesic flow. So you have a vector field X, it defines a differential operator, and so you have this inverse. And so this extension is does not appear from nowhere. I mean, it's a very difficult result. And to prove such a result, you construct a nice functional space on which the flow will act, will behave nicely. So typically, you construct anisotropic Sobolev spaces by asking, for example, by asking your distributions to be very smooth in one direction and very and to have a lot of singularity in other direction, and those two directions are the stable and the unstable direction of the flow. And for those who know hyperbolic dynamics, you have if you are in a negative curvature, the geodesic flow is hyperbolic in the sense that there is one direction which is stretched and one direction which is expanded. And so you construct some functional space adapted to the dynamics, and on those spaces, the geodesic flow behaves well. So the construction of anisotropic Sobolev spaces was for another flows was introduced by Fohr and Zylstrand, and later by Dyatlov and Zworski as well, who used semi-classical analysis to understand the wavefront set of the resolvent R of S. But I will come to that maybe later. Okay, so that's great. So I will explain later why I introduced this resolvent. So now I come back to why did I introduce this resolvent? So the answer is now. So I call I the inclusion of the vectors based at my geodesic gamma star. It's just the inclusion of the vector based at gamma star into the whole sphere bundle. Okay, And so what I want to say, so it is a complicated formula, and it's a proposition, I'm sorry for the proposition, is the following, is that you have a formula that relates the scattering operator are introduced before and the resolvent I just introduced before. So this formula says roughly the following. It says that you take a function on which is supported on vectors based at your geodesic gamma star. So don't forget that n star is a space of vectors based at gamma star. You take a function, you see that as a distribution on all the manifold, you apply the resolvent here. Okay. So when you do this push forward I star, you obtain one form. Well, because the push forward of a function, which is on a submanifold of dimension 2, becomes a one form. So you obtain a one form. You apply the resolvent because the resolvent is still defined also for one forms. Then you contract it with the geodesic vector field, and then you restrict it to the boundary again. Okay, so I'm sorry for this part, which is a bit a bit complicated, but the main thing you want to understand is the following, is that you have a formula which relates the resolvent of the geodesic flow inside of the total manifold and the scattering operator, which is defined at the boundary. So this is the main thing you want to remember. And so, of course, if you want to restrict the resolvent at the boundary, I mean, it's an operator, so you cannot do whatever you want. You cannot apply your operator to any distribution. So you want your distribution to satisfy certain properties that allow you to apply your operator. And so what I was saying earlier is that the work of Dyatlov Guillermou, in the same spirit of the work of Dyatlov Zorsky, allows you to recover the Ermander wavefront set of the resolvent. And so it tells you that the above formula makes sense. It tells you that I have the right to write this formula, and indeed I recover the scattering operator. So now, as I know that the resolvent of the geodesic flow extends meromorphically to the whole complex plane, I also know that my scattering operator with the parametral my spectral parameter S here extends meromorphically to a family on the whole complex plane. Okay, so you just have to remember that. Okay, and now it's great. And why it's great? Because as I was saying at the beginning of the talk, if I can understand a certain zeta function and I can understand the analytic behavior of this zeta function at some pole, I will be able to recover informations on the coefficients of my zeta functions. And in this case, the coefficient will be the closed geodesics that intersect a right number of times gamma star. Okay, so why did I introduce this scattering operator? It is because when I want to understand the fixed points of diffeomorphism, for example, I can look at the trace of the associated transfer operator. So what do I mean by this? Is that, for example, if you take any diffeomorphism of a manifold M, okay, and you look at the operator which acts on differential forms, which is defined just by the pullback, okay, so which is exactly my scattering operator. And then you have a trace formula for this operator, which is the Atiyah-Abbott trace formula, which says the following, which says that there is some kind of trace that you can define, which is a weak trace, because of course the operator big F is not trace class, but you have a weak form of the trace which you can apply to the operator and which gives you a sum on the fixed points of your diffeomorphism. So this is really important, and it allows you to recover the fixed points of your diffeomorphism by computing the trace of some transfer operator. Okay, so, and if you remember, I want to understand the fixed points of the scattering map, so I want to understand the trace of the transfer operator, which is my scattering operator. Okay, so here, if you are interested, the flat trace is an alternate sum of a flat trace of the operator, what I call here trace flat S here, is just an alternate sum of a real flat trace when I restrict my operator to act on differential forms, and the trace of some operator which acts on sections of a vector bundle, it's simply the integral, okay, here it should be an integral over M, I'm sorry. It's the integral of the trace of the Schwarz kernel of my operator. Okay, and of course, this formula makes sense if the Schwarz kernel is smooth, but if it is not smooth, for some distributions, for some Schwarz kernel, you can still define this integral by looking at the wavefront set properties of this Schwarz kernel. Okay, so now you see me coming, and I will apply this trace to my scattering operator. Okay, so of course, as I said earlier, my scattering operator sends functions who are supported on incoming vectors to functions who are supported on outgoing vectors, or the opposite, I don't know. So I need to identify incoming vectors and outgoing vectors just to see my operator acting on the same space. Okay, so I just call psi, is just the identification between an incoming vector and an outgoing vector. Okay, and I look at the scattering operator, which is just, okay, I have a scattering operator, it sends me a function supported on outgoing vectors to a function on incoming vectors, and then I identify again to obtain really an operator. I want to compose this operator. And so the problem is that you want to compose this operator to obtain fixed points of iterates of the scattering map. Yeah.
Could you re-explain why the problem you study corresponds to fixed points of the iterates? Of the operator.
Yeah, okay. So what I did not say is that, okay, if I take one iterate, the fixed point of the scattering map will give me the closed geodesic that intersect one time. Okay, so I take this vector, and if I come back exactly at the same place, then it will give me a closed geodesic that intersect one time. Okay, now I take a vector, I come out somewhere, I take this vector and I launch again the geodesic flow. And then I come back at another place. And if this place is exactly the first one, then it means that I have a geodesic which intersects two times. Okay? So in fact, I want to understand the fixed point of the composition of the scattering map n times. And so I want to understand the composition of the transfer operators n times. So, yes, thank you very much. I did not well explain that. So okay, and thus I want to compose my scattering operators. The thing is, my scattering operators are very singular. Even if I have the formula that relates them to the resolvent, I know a bit it's a wavefront set, but I want to be sure that I can compose them. And in fact, I cannot compose them microlocally near vectors which are tangent. Because if you take a very tangent vector, then it will do a lot of turns, and it makes the analysis very complicated. And you can see by looking at the wavefront set that you are not allowed to compose these operators microlocally near the tangent vectors. And so what you do is that you take a cutoff function which is zero near the tangent vectors, and you just multiply your scattering operator by this cutoff function. Okay, it's just I forget about vectors which are very, very tangent. And if I do that, then by looking at the wavefront set properties of your scattering operator, you see that you are able to compose them. And what you can show as well is that you have kind of trace formula, which is the following. Okay, so it's very complicated, but it just says the following. It just says that the trace of your scattering operators that you composed n times is a kind of, I don't know, Poincaré series or Dirichlet series, where the sum runs over closed geodesics intersecting n times. Just by analogy with the T-Abbott trace formula, when I take the trace of the transfer operator, I recover my fixed points or my periodic points if I compose my operator. And the thing is, of course, I cannot apply the T-Abbott trace formula like this because my operator has a lot of singularities. So I mean, it's not obvious that you can apply the formula. You have to do some analysis to understand a bit the singularity. I see that some drawing here. Okay, so you need to understand a bit the singularities before to make sure that you can apply this formula. And in fact, you have to take some limits with cutoffs. And okay, so just to say that I have a zeta function which is related to the trace of my scattering operator. And now I want to apply some Tauberian theorem to obtain an asymptotic on my geodesics. Okay, so I see that I have only a few minutes left, so sorry if I'm a bit fast on the last slides. Okay, so remember that you know that the resolvent R of S is meromorphic. So it means that it has poles with you have a Laurent development at each pole, and in fact the work of Paris-Polycott, which says that the zeta function for the open problem has a simple pole of residue one at the entropy of the cutting surface, implies a result on the development of the resolvent, because you can recover the zeta function with the resolvent. And it says that the resolvent has a simple pole at S equal the entropy of the open surface, with a rank one operator A. Okay, so this is just the residue of this operator R of S. And since we established a link between my scattering operator S of S and R of S, then I also have this kind of development for my scattering operator, which tells me that my scattering operator here can be written as a holomorphic family of operator plus a singular part which has residue B, which depends on chi, my cutoff, of course, but with a simple pole. And also, I know that B chi is a rank one operator, since here the residue is a rank one operator. Okay, so now I just take the trace of this formula, and since B chi is a rank one operator, then when I compute the trace of B chi to the power n, it is just the trace of B chi to the power n. If you have a rank one operator, when you look at the trace of A to the power n, you just obtain trace of A to the power n. And just what you obtain is that the trace of your scattering operator composed n times with itself is equal to C chi, so C chi is the trace of B chi, to the power n divided by S minus H star to the power n. So this is the singular part. I mean, and just because you just compose this expression here, okay? Okay, so that's great because here you know at which speed this trace explodes when you approach the first pole. But also you know that this trace is linked by the trace formula I showed earlier, is linked to the closed geodesics, to a Dirichlet series involving the closed geodesics that you are interested in. And so you can apply your Tauberian theorem and you obtain that the number, so here it's complicated, but this big product is equal to one if chi is a constant function equal to one, what you want to take. So it's just coefficients, but this big thing is what you want to count, is roughly speaking, the number of closed geodesics that intersect n times gamma star with some coefficients you add because you want to remove very tangent ones. And so it gives you the right formula just by applying the theorem, the Tauberian theorem of Delange. And of course, you don't want geodesic that are far from the tangent direction. You want every geodesic. So you want to do, you want to take the limit when chi, sorry, somebody is calling me, so I will refuse this call, sorry. And so you want to take the limit when chi tends to the constant function equal to one. And in fact, you can do this because if you look at a closed geodesic that intersect with a very small angle, then there are not too much geodesic like that, because if you intersect with a small angle, then you have to do a lot of turns. So it just means that only those kind of geodesics can intersect with a small angle, and thus it is not the majority. Sorry, this person is calling me again. It's my mother actually, so I'm really sorry about this. And so you can take the limit, and you can intervert both limits. So here you have a limit, which is just the equivalent statement, and that you can show that by using a priori estimates that you can take the limit. And what I did not say as well is that to apply this arguing like that, you have to show that there are enough closed geodesics that satisfy new constraints. And to do this, you can do geometrical arguments by using like cat minus one, the theory of cat minus one spaces to show that, okay, there are enough closed geodesics satisfying those constraints. And thus, those terms here cannot be zero. It has to be positive, and thus you can do this. This proof. Okay, so I will stop now, and I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for the talk, Jan.
Thank you.
We have time for questions. So if someone has a question, you can ask it in the chat, or just unmute yourself and ask your question.
I have a quick comment, but I have to leave like in a minute to.
Okay.
So there is a related problem with some important mathematical physics connections. This is Zieber-Richter pairs. It's counting orbits that come back to in sort of self-intersect, but also with very close. Direction. So it is approximate. You cannot exactly intersect with the same direction, of course, but there is some counting. And I would suggest you talk to Martin Zieber, who is at Bristol. And these orbits are called Zieber-Richter pairs now. They're very prominent in quantum chaos.
Okay, so Martin Zieber, you say?
Martin Zieber, yes.
Okay.
I'll put it in the chat as well.
Thank you.
Great talk, by the way.
I'm Martin Zieber. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Does anyone else have a question or comment for Jan?
Yeah, I was wondering, does the main result, does it work for n equals zero? Because the situation is actually really different. You don't have this interpretation of things as fixed points.
No, of course, of course.
Okay. So yes, can you say something in that case?
For n equals zero, it is... in fact, the result was already known, but I don't prove it. I just use it.
Okay, and so is it a very different? Did you write it somewhere? Or is it very different the way
for n equals zero? I believe that you can do the proof like Margulis did. I think it follows from the work of Roblin, which uses the mixing properties of the geodesic flow and the equidistribution of closed orbits. But you can also use the work of Paris-Polycott, who showed that if you have a topologically weak mixing axiom A flow, then you will have this estimate.
Okay, and so here you have the Margulis thing, but with the topological entropy of the...
Yes.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, so just this formula is consistent with n equals zero. I don't know if that was your question, but...
Yeah.
And so if you want to use the result of Paris and Polycott, you have to show that the geodesic flow restricted to the trap set is a weak mixing. And so it follows from a result of Dalbo.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wants to ask something or comment?
Can I ask one question about, I think it was maybe the next slide or maybe two, where you have several geodesics instead of just one of them?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this one. Is there a limit on the number of geodesics that you can put in there, or can you take arbitrarily large number, or does it depend on L, for example?
No, I can take an arbitrary large number, but I want them to be pairwise disjoint. So I cannot take an arbitrary large number. So I believe that the largest number I can take is the number of simple closed geodesics that you will have to take if you want a Pantz decomposition of your surface.
I see. Like that. Yeah, somebody says in the chat 3G minus 3. So I think that's, yes, that makes sense.
Okay, so that's it. So no worry, it depends on the topology.
For sure, thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? If not, let's thank Jan again. Thank you for this great talk. And let me thank everyone for attending the seminar this semester. We will take a break starting now, and we will resume in January. So on January 17, with a talk by Alexey Kloman, which will be followed by a talk by Grigory Berkolaiko. So the talks have been swapped. If you look on the webpage, it's not the proper information, but please make sure to look and you will receive the usual invitation letter. So I wish everyone a good break if they have one. And if not, well, you should take one.